Thank you, Andy, for that beautiful piano prelude. At least I think so. Sorry for the premature clapping there, by the way. But, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you. And I would say Happy New Year, but we will be together again on New Year's Day. So we'll hold that for next week. But every few years, or every several years, I guess, we have the privilege of worshiping together on Christmas morning. And I think it's a privilege, don't you? Even though there may be a kid or two in the sanctuary this morning who thinks otherwise. But I did get a text about 10 this morning, someone asking, are we really having Sunday service on Christmas? And I text back, yes, Pastor Jonathan, we are. You need to get your Bible, your notes, and get over here. Let's get going. Anyways, there is no place I would rather be, though, this morning than in church worshiping together. At this time, we are going to enjoy a number from our Bells of Faith.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bells of Faith. That was beautiful. Well, again, it's good to be with you this Sunday morning. And many of you were here last night. In fact, there was a lot of people here last night for the Christmas Eve candlelight service. I was surprised, actually, how many came out last night. We had a lot of visitors, a lot of community people, and just family. That has just been such a special time over the years here at our church, and we appreciate many of you welcoming all who were here. And trustees, I apologize in advance for the fire damage there may be over in that corner. I lit probably about 8 or 10 little kids' candles over there, and I went home, I had wax on my pants, and I'm sure there's wax on the carpet, but hey, that's fine. That's what we got to put up with, right? Well, a few announcements just before we get into worship. This is the week between Christmas and New Year, so we're used to kind of having things slow down. And in fact, there's no programs happening, no groups meeting on Wednesday night. And there's also no groups meeting next Sunday at 9:30. The next time we will be together is 10:30, next Sunday morning, New Year's Day. And so take note of that. There's other things mentioned in the bulletin that you will want to take note of. A couple things being next Sunday is also First Sunday. So that means, what does that mean, First Sunday? Yeah. Communion, I think I heard communion, which that's true. And the other one is bring in your non-perishable food items for Maywood Mission. So don't forget to do that as well. And then there's other things mentioned in the bulletin related to teen events coming up, such as Winter Jam and the tubing trip. That's snow tubing, not water tubing. Yes. Well, I think that is all that I have. So at this time, let's stand and prepare our hearts for worship and song as we pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, again, it is a privilege and an honor, Lord, to be able to come together on this day that we remember your birthday, Lord, but we also recognize you this morning as King of Kings and Lord of all, Lord, and it is my prayer and hope that each one in here this morning can also say with confidence that you are Lord of their hearts. And Lord, we also know that without the first advent, there wouldn't be a second, Lord, and we anticipate you coming again. And Lord, on this new year that's coming up, Lord, we may our first and foremost resolution be to ready ourselves for your coming again. Lord, and to also be willing and ready to speak the gospel, Lord, to have those conversations so that others around us can be ready as well. But Lord, today we're here. Lord, we recognize you as Lord. And we come together to give you the honor and praise that you so much deserve. We look back over this last year, and we see your hand working in so many ways, not only in our church, in our groups, our children's programs, our youth programs, in the other aspects of ministry that's happening, Lord, but also in our families, Lord, and in our community, Lord. And we just thank you for the year that you have blessed us with, Lord, and we anticipate just your moving in our church in a way that we haven't seen maybe yet in the coming year in 2023. Now, Lord, we just pray that you bless Pastor Mike and all those in the music as they lead us into your presence in song, and then in a few moments, Pastor Jonathan, as he opens up the word to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Christ is born today, all the NASB before him bow. you may be seated. Such a wonderful, awesome place to be on Christmas morning. Great, the Lord's birth, and we thank you for coming. We hope you enjoy today and just rejoice and praise him this morning. We're going to take up the offering. If the ushers would come, please. Let's pray together. Lord, we love you and praise you, and we do look back at this day as we celebrate the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we love you and praise you. We thank you for all that you do in our lives, how you protect us and how you provide for us. And we ask you, Lord, just to bless this offering. We thank you for all of those that have to give. We just ask you to use it for the betterment of your kingdom. We give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
Thank you. Merry Christmas. It is good to see you this morning. I'm glad you're here. Glad you showed up. I have been falsely accused of something that did not happen this morning, and I just wanted to clarify that. But I want you all to greet Aaron, especially before you leave today, because this will be the last time that you will see him. And so I just want you to greet him and express how much you've appreciated him over the years. We're going to keep Rachel and the kids, but you know, we're pretty much done with Aaron. It's good to see you. Good that we could be together today. I really deeply appreciate you coming today. It's cold, it's frigid, it's wintry weather. We gathered last night. This is a quick turnaround, but we're glad you're here. And thank you for joining today. And we're going to look together at God's Word, and we're trusting Him for His leading on this Christmas Sunday. And for that, we are grateful. We're going to look at Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 7 today. And the consideration for this moment of time we're together is the title, The Prophet's Referral. The Prophet's Referral. He may not have necessarily put it in that term or put it in those terms, but this is the greatest referral one could ever give. Keep that in mind as we look together at this text. We know that from Isaiah the prophet, there are more messianic texts than any other prophet. Everywhere you turn in Isaiah, in the 66 chapters of Isaiah, it's just one prophetic reference after another of the Messiah. The Messiah, chock full of wonderful references. We know that Isaiah is divided into sections, and we know that really this falls in, chapter 9, falls in a section of the prophecies of this great man as a time of judgment or as a reference of judgment. But in the middle of judgment, there is great hope. It's almost as if he could not contain himself, especially as we look at this grand passage in Isaiah 9. Interesting grammatically for us before we read it is this. It is in the perfect tense. And we might say, I didn't do well in grammar. Well, if you didn't, that's okay. But the perfect tense means really its application is in the ever-present. It is in the ever-present. So as we read this, we don't just look at the past, we don't look at the present, and we don't focus merely on the future. We recognize this is always this grand truth and revelation. It's always intact. The prophet may not have understood everything that God impressed upon his heart. He may have had a local application to this truth. In fact, there's always, to true prophecy, there's always a local application. Whether or not the prophecy has come to its full fruition or not, there's always local application. So with that in mind, we read from this text. But there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea on the other side of the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. You shall multiply the nation. You shall increase their gladness. They will be glad in your presence as with the gladness of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you shall break the yoke of their burden and the staff on their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, as at the battle of Midian. For every boot of the booted warrior in the battle tumult and cloak rolled in blood will be for burning fuel for the fire. For a child will be born to us, A son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of his peace on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. The early part of this great prophecy begins with quite a problem: darkness, gloom. All that would be really encapsulated in that kind of a condition and a context. Darkness, difficulty, despair, gloom. In Scripture, darkness is always the opposite of God's presence. So it means that bad things are upon those who are being listed in the text. So we might ask the question, probably as they might have been asking the question, how do we get out of the darkness? Where do we turn? Is there a way out? Can we get out of the darkness? Well, according to the great prophet Isaiah, he has the best hope of anyone to give a referral imaginable. Now, I'm not doing this in any way, shape, or form to be irreverent or to be trite, but I have imagined from time to time, what if Jesus had an office? Now, he was here in the flesh. We know that he did come into this world. He was God incarnate. He was God in flesh. So he was here for a while. But we also know that he didn't even have a place to lay his head to call his own. And we know that. Scripture reminds us of that. And those who would have followed after him, he also reminded them of that very fact. Come and see how I live. Come and check it out. Pretty Spartan. Pretty sparse. But what if he had an office? You know, I've visited a lot of offices in my day. All kinds of leaders and all kinds of characters. I've visited doctor's offices before, as probably you have too. I often check out what's on the wall. I want to know if they really have credibility. I want to know if they've been adequately trained. Right? I want to know if they really can be trusted. I check out the walls. Why? What do? We don't just put artwork on the walls. Usually, there's some degree posted there or some kind of an accolade. Won a prize for the best knee job you can get. Something like that. Just something to give us a little breath of hope that the person we're about to talk to knows what in the world they're doing and can do it for us. Right? We look for some kind of assurance, some kind of confirmation, an affirmation of sorts, that the individual to whom we have been sent or the one to whom we have been referred can help us with our problem. So if Jesus had an office, what would be on his office walls? If we went in to see him, if someone referred us to him, what would we find? Well, I think out of all of it, his beginnings would likely shock us, and the whole idea, his youth, would probably scare us too. Were you with me when I read the text? A child is born. A son is given. I've talked to a lot of you, and when you've gone to the doctor, you've said, well, that person's awfully young. And I wonder sometimes why you say it that way. There's a sense in which, is this person really know what they're doing? God confounds the wisdom of the world when he sends to us in our darkness a child. I like what God does. He takes the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. He takes the wisdom of the world, turns it on its ear. That's what God does. But here's what we might see. Wonderful Counselor. Wonderful Counselor. Jesus is a personal, always a personal wonder. Everything about Jesus is indeed wonderful. I know that we use these kinds of statements, probably overuse them, maybe abuse them, but if anyone was ever deserving of this qualifier, wonderful, it's Jesus. He is the wonderful one who gives marvelous counsel. And he is a marvelous one who gives counsel. This in every regard is in reference to his omniscience. Those big theological words sometimes that we throw about. But it doesn't mean in kind of a sterile or static way that he knows all there is to know and can yield then and offer perfect counsel, but he is an engaged counselor. He's a personal counselor, and he has as his objective not just giving us something to do or a course to take or some kind of a directive to consider, but Jesus is a wonderful counselor because in every way he is winsomely engaged for your good and mine in everything that he ever says. I want to say to you that as a pastor, along with this prophet, I am glad to be able to refer you to Jesus. He is a perfect counselor all the time. And I also want to remind you that when you call on him, you won't get voicemail. You'll get him. And when you get him, you get a perfect counselor for every concern you have, for every time you might have it, you have a perfect counselor. He is a wonderful counselor. I like the idea that what we don't know and what we would necessarily have difficulty trying to figure out, take it to Jesus. Take it to Jesus. I just want to refer you to Jesus today. He's a wonderful counselor. He knows everything that we need him to know, and it's always for our good. Second thing you might find would be that he is mighty God. Now, I want you to know that it's always good to hear sound truth. It's always good to find wonderful counseling. It is always a blessing to be directed in the right way. But it is even more assuring to know that the one who is giving us counsel, the one who is directing us, is actually the one who is powerful enough to make real in us what he's counseling us as to what we need. When he says, "This is what you need," he doesn't say, "Now, go down the street, here's a prescription, go get it filled, hope it works." No, backed up behind wonderful counselor is mighty God. So that when he tells us, "Here's what you need," he doesn't send us anywhere else. He doesn't give us another referral. You know, I was talking with Dr. Hermes about the whole Florida health kind of interesting system. Before he could get some help, last time he was in Florida and had a little bit of a fall and had a difficulty, he had been referred to 19 different doctors. What a racket. I mean, honestly, what a racket. "Oh, you hurt your left knee. I only do right knees." It's amazing. I mean, it's just amazing to me. I'm so thankful that in the case of Jesus, the child, the son, he doesn't just give us wonderful counsel and then says, "Now, you'll need to go there. You'll need, and I'll give you directions. Here's the address, or here's the prescription." He is mighty God. What is this statement telling us? Jesus is not superhuman. Jesus is every bit God. He is God. Let me say that again. He is God. And as a result, His essence, His nature, this is who He is. This speaks then of the natural reality to Jesus, that He's not only omniscient, but He's omnipotent. Another one of those great theological words. He is mighty God. Third thing we might find on the wall is something remarkable. Again, in the form of a child, in the form of a son given to us. Everlasting Father. Everlasting Father. A lot of scholars have tried to figure out exactly what this means, but there are some credible sources, wise in Hebrew especially, that declare that what is being said here is staggering in this sense. He indeed is the Father of everything that is eternal. Now think about that. He's not only a wonderful, marvelous counselor, and not only is He the mighty one, He is God, but because of that, He doesn't just dole out eternal help. He doesn't just give to us everlasting life. He, in fact, is the source of everything that would ever be categorized as eternal. He holds it. He owns it. He's the source of it. So, again, another good reason why I want to refer you to Jesus. Oh, you can trust His counsel. He knows everything. Oh, you can depend on Him. He's mighty God. But I want to send you to Jesus because He is the source of eternity. He's the source of everything that is eternal. He's the one who gives that which is everlasting life. Boy, the prophet knew what he was doing, didn't he? I'm going to refer you to this child. I'm going to refer you to this son. So He doesn't just have at His disposal eternity. He is eternity. He is the source of it, the origin of it. This is fitting that Hebrews reminds us of how perfect of a high priest we have. We have a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. A priest forever. Praise His name. Because He's a priest forever, because He is everywhere present at the same time, because there is no point in time or space wherein He is not present, then this is that other kind of big-ticket theological word that reminds us of His omnipresence. He's here today. Because over two or three are here, gathered in His name, He is here. He is here. Hallelujah. He is here. Amen. He is here. You can touch Him. Amen. But getting out of the darkness, I'm so thankful He's Prince of Peace. We're referred to the One who is doing everything that He is doing, fulfilling the Father's plan, maintaining the purpose that is in God's great heart to bring about your well-being and mine. He's the perfect ruler of a perfect kingdom. I just want to remind us of that. Don't gauge your hopes and don't place your hope in just what you see here. Oh man, heaven and earth will pass away. But he is absolutely, unmovably the same. And everything that he does is perfect. Everything that he accomplishes is without fault. He does everything well. So as a ruler, he's a perfect ruler. As setting up a kingdom, it's a perfect kingdom. You might say, well, how can that be? There are people there. Well, there's a day of glorification coming, which I know I need. Let me just let you in on a secret. You need it too. But there's a day coming when that which is frail, feeble, weak, flawed, will put on that which is glorified, perfect, by the Lord's doing. Eternal and holy, impeccable, because of him. He is the Prince of Peace. He's generous. He's beneficent. He is a prince who cares so much for you and for me that he will do all that he can do to bring about a condition of well-being in you and in me. Greater minds than mine have dubbed this part of the prophet's referral as his omnificence, unlimited in creative potency, generous in doing good, all to bring about your well-being and mine. So let me just say this to you again. If you ever came to me and said, Pastor, this is happening or that's happening, kind of going through a dark time, can you refer me to someone? Yes, I can. Yes, I can. And I think, friends, while we appreciate those who do God's work well and serve in various roles that we could even describe as a calling, I want to remind us all of this. I cannot refer you to a human being anywhere close in capability than to what Isaiah was saying in this point in his life. A child is born, and a son has been given to us. He has a name. He has titles. They're perfect. Wonderful Counselor. Mighty God. Eternal Father. Prince of Peace. I guarantee you something. I can guarantee this. You know, there's not a whole lot you can guarantee today. I'm almost reluctant anymore if somebody tells me, have you been to a decent restaurant lately? By the way, especially with how help is today, no. I haven't. Tough day as far as finding someone who could cook back there where the meal will be even anywhere close to what you ordered. Just that kind of a day. Hard to get good help today. There's a lot that we are not comfortable anymore recommending. Case in point, I won't tell you the restaurant, but the initials are C and B, and there's a cracker and a barrel in it. But I didn't tell you. I didn't tell you exactly which restaurant. I know this might seem a surprise to you, but I actually like grits. Good grits. Grits cooked correctly. Sharma and I stopped for a bite to eat. The fire was beautiful. We were seated in a comfortable place. The meal was an absolute total disaster. And I want to tell you something. For those of you who think you can't kill breakfast, yes, you can. I'm just here to tell you, yes, you can. I like my bacon crispy. I don't want to be able to just Move it around. And when it comes like that, I ask them to do better. Then it comes back burned beyond recognition. My eggs were cold. And my grits, I told Sharma, my grits I could have just consumed with a straw. It was just liquid with an occasional strange, kind of rare little kernel in it. So I just want you to know, if somebody asks me, I'm not recommending certain things anymore. And our poor waitress, she said, I know. She said, if we go back there and say anything, we just get yelled at by the cooks. I said, well, bless your heart. Here's an extra tip. Merry Christmas. Not much you can recommend today. In fact, you know, it's this way with everything. One person will just brag on a doctor. I'm telling you what, I could never do this before until I had this surgeon do this. And then you have one, I'll never go to him again. My foot's aiming the wrong way. You know, whatever it is. It's hard to find anything or anyone you can recommend. Isn't that true? So we're reluctant in that regard. Here's where I'm not reluctant. And where you should not be reluctant either. We can recommend Jesus and never, ever, ever blink. We can recommend Jesus and never, ever think, well, I hope he can counsel them. I hope he has the power to help them. I hope he can bring them well-being. We can refer anyone to Jesus and never, ever, ever flinch. And always know he's a perfect referral. So the prophet said, I want you to know something. We're coming out of darkness. Praise God. We're in kind of a dark day too. But don't fret and don't lament and don't lose your faith. Because while it might be dark, there's a way out. There's a way out. We have a perfect referral in Jesus. Amen. Aren't we thankful? What an amazing thing. God did all of that in the birth of a child, in the giving to us of a son. Praise his name. Well, would you stand with me, please? We're going to sing, and we should, right? We're going to sing. And there are rules, by the way, to singing. Now, even if you're not on tune, we are to sing robustly. And this is one of those numbers when you have to sing it robustly. So before we sing, let me pray for you to be able to sing robustly. Father, we're here to give you praise. We are here to honor Jesus, the Messiah. We are here to worship. It's only fitting then that we close this service with not only recognizing the fact that Jesus, you have come, but also with great hope, announcing to the world with our loudest of voice, you are the one who is to come. So we join in singing today, joy to the world. Bless us as we sing, encourage us in who you are, and remind us of the blessings that we have in Christ Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Have a wonderful rest of this day. Be careful as you leave and as you travel home. But God bless you again. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.